Welcome to the Iowa City Public Library, and thank you for coming to tonight's program. This program is live on Library Channel 20, and the program will be rebroadcast. You will also be able to watch the program at video-stream.icpl.org. Thank you also to Prairie Lights for the co-sponsorship of this evening with quilters, a fabric artist, and a quilter who writes. While tonight's program is ostensibly about the spectacularly beautiful new book, Art Quilts of the Midwest, edited by Linzee Kull McCray, I think it's also about more than that. In the introduction to Art Quilts, Astrid writes, "Midwestern quilters and other artists often have a strong relation to landscape and social groups. And for me, this book is also about friends and the Longfellow neighborhood. I happen to know all three of our speakers this evening, and not because they quilt, but because they walk their dogs." Linzee and Pearl, Erick and Taffy, and Astrid and Tuck. And there are a number of other people and their dogs who are not here out there in the audience. And we see them on the same sidewalks as Nellie and I, my dog. And even though they may not make quilts with the Longfellow neighborhood or all the other dog walkers and the dogs they meet in mind, I have a feeling that while they're cutting, piecing, and creating, what they saw, heard, smelled, or touched on their walks is part of their beautiful creations. So I'm going to introduce the three guests tonight and then turn it over to Linzee, and she'll talk and take questions, and then Astrid, and she'll speak and take questions, and then Erick, and the same, although Erick actually has a video for us to watch tonight. Astrid Hilger Bennett wrote the foreword to Art Quilts of the Midwest. Astrid received her BFA in printmaking from Indiana University and has exhibited and taught at various locations throughout the country. Her work has been included in Quilt National, Quilt Nihon, Quilt Equal Art Equal Quilts, Art Quilt Elements, Form Not Function, Art Quilts of the Carnegie, and more. She is a member of the Surface Design Association, the Studio Art Quilt Association, and the Art American Crafts Council. Astrid is a longtime resident of Iowa City and was the longtime manager, now marketing director, of the Iowa Artisans Gallery. Erick Wolfmeyer holds a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Photography from Washington University. Erick is the only Iowa artist featured in Art Quilts of the Midwest. For years, Erick lived in small towns and drove a school bus to support his art. He now lives in Iowa City and walks in the Longfellow neighborhood with his dog, Taffy, who's a beautiful dog, by the way, and it's a pit bull or a mix, and there's nothing to be afraid of. Taffy has to be the sweetest dog in the whole neighborhood, maybe. He now lives in Iowa City and holds a full-time job, but he still lives frugally. His quilts can take up to 6 months to complete. His quilts have been included in numerous shows. He was one of five quilters invited to travel to China in 2012 as part of the U.S. Embassy-sponsored exhibition, The Sum of Many Parts, 25 Quilt Makers in the 21st Century America. His most recent exhibition was at St. Ambrose University this past September and October. Borrowing freely from Linzee's website, Linzee has been an art teacher, a bartender, who knew, a book publicist. She's taught childbirth education to expectant parents and magazine writing to journalism undergraduates. She has a Bachelor of Art in English from St. Olaf, a Master of Art in Therapeutic Recreation, and a Master of Art in Journalism, both from the University of Iowa. After working for 13 years as a University of Iowa writer and editor, she is now freelancing full-time. She specializes in writing and photography for craft, art, and textile-related publications and blogs. She also writes for and edits publications that cover topics ranging from historic cookbooks to digital archiving to children's hearing loss. She is a columnist for the French magazine Quilt Country. She has 2 decades of experience writing for magazines including Stitch, American Patchwork and Quilting, Uppercase, Quilts and More, Quilt Sampler, Parents and Others. And I'm proud to say that Linzee has also been a board member of the Iowa City Public Library for two 2-year terms. All they would still equal 12 years. And as she so perfectly describes herself, "I am fascinated by people's passions and have never written a profile I didn't enjoy. I am consistently inspired by the work I encounter, the people I get to know through my writing." Linzee.
Thank you.
Okay.
We don't, and I won't need that for a minute, but yeah, that's good. Okay. All right. Thanks. Thank you guys all so much for coming. I can't tell you just how wonderful it is to see so many familiar faces, some unfamiliar faces really is exciting too. And I really appreciate your support and coming out. I also have to say that I have to thank two of the best institutions in the Midwest, and that would be the Iowa City Public Library and Prairie Lights Books. Having lived elsewhere, I can tell you they are two of the best institutions in the Midwest. And I just feel really honored to be here and have, be part of their programming and for them to invite Erick and Astrid and I. So thank you, Jan and Susan in the library. And Beth, also for all your assistance, and Maeve. I'm going to just tell you briefly about how the idea for the book came about, and then I'll just talk about a few of the artists. And I hope that you'll take a look at the book because there are many more. We obviously can't talk about all of them tonight. But the idea for the book came about when Holly Carver and I, who's an editor and former director at the UI Press, were talking. She was interested in a book about quilts for her Burr Oak book series. And I was trying to think of what angle would interest me. And as someone who moved here from California first in the 1970s, I always noticed, I had a lot of friends who were artists, and I always noticed that my color sensibility was different than theirs. I had just a visual difference in what appealed to me, visual aesthetic. And it wasn't until I later moved back, 11 years later, to California that I was suddenly realized, oh, this is it. I grew up in California, and I was almost always in the view of water. I could see the ocean most of my life, and in the summers, we spent summer in northern Minnesota, and I was on a lake, and the colors that appealed to me were always blues and greens and sort of watercolors. And I really have thought a lot over the years. Then we moved back to Iowa City in 1991. I've been here a lot of years now. I think Iowa is beautiful. It took me a while, but I love it, and except maybe in February. And I think it's just something that I've thought a lot about. How does someone hone their visual sense, their visual aesthetic? And I really do think there's something about where you grow up. And actually, I did a little looking, very little into research, but there is actual research that shows that where you grow up can actually have an effect on how you see the world in terms of interacting with the environment and a lot of other elements. So, but my feeling was much less scientific than that. I just really felt it had an impact. So we put out a call to artists in a number of different locations, organizations and online journals and that kind of thing for quilt artists to participate, to send in three quilts that would be inspired by work, three pieces of art that they had done that were inspired by the Midwest. And we got nearly 100 entries and really high quality work. It was, you know, everyone always says, oh, it's so hard to choose, but it was hard to choose. And I think that that really helped this book be such a strong book because we had such a wonderful base to choose from. I had Emily Martin and Mary Merkel Hess, who are both Iowa City artists, were the people who helped jury the book. And I was not sure when I did it whether it was a good idea to have non-quilt artists be the jurors. And I wrote to a woman that I've collaborated with at the International Quilt Study Center in Lincoln, Nebraska, where you can actually get a PhD in quilt studies, something I would just love to do someday. And they have a museum, and Carolyn Ducey's a curator there. And she said to me, I think it's an excellent idea to have non-quilt artists as jurors. She said, I think it will give a fresh viewpoint. You're not going to get people who know the big names in art quilting. And I really think when I got this book and I got to hold it for the first time and I flipped through it, that I was just so thrilled that we had such a breadth of work. There's just a real variety of artists, and that makes me really happy. And I really thank Emily and Mary for helping me make those selections. So that's kind of how the book came about. And if I can remember, Maeve. Arrows, okay. To start it?
Yeah, it's already started.
Okay, so this is the cover of the book, and this artist is, this is a detail by Shinhee Chin. She's an artist from Kansas, and I'll talk about her in a minute because I have another piece of hers that I've included. But I'm going to show you the work of about 7 different artists and talk a little bit about what inspired them in the Midwest. I also, when I said I'd never had a profile, I didn't enjoy writing, I just love finding out what makes people tick, what gets them up in the morning, what they're passionate about. And that was what was so fun for me. I wrote the 20, I interviewed each of the artists. I talked with them for at least an hour. Some of them we talked much more, and wrote a short, very short profile. But it was so fun to learn what their inspirations were. This is Gail Barr, and she's from Buffalo Grove, Illinois. And Gail is a musician, and she said she's been told that she has a lot of movement in her quilts, and that might be from music. But her Midwest inspiration comes from, she grew up in southern Minnesota, and she said that she was very inspired by the wide open fields and prairies. And every summer her family would go from southern Minnesota, they would drive up to their place on Lake Superior. And she just remembered driving by these big barns and these barges, big ore boats that were on the lake, and that really inspired her love of these big, big shapes. And she doesn't want to use too many colors in a piece because she said that distracts from the shapes. She likes her shapes to be somewhat straight, but she wants them to look that, she wants you to be able to tell that they were cut by a person. So she doesn't use a ruler to cut them. She wants them to be slightly off. And she uses very simple matchstick quilting so that it doesn't distract from the work, from the shapes again, which she just loves so much. She dyes her fabrics herself, and she really enjoys the summer in the Midwest because she said she puts her dye pots out in the sun and that helps intensify the color. So she has many Midwestern influences. And I should have said that at the beginning, everyone who has these influences, of course, has many other influences as well. I mean, no one in the Midwest anymore is isolated. Many of these artists maybe didn't come originally from the Midwest. They may have moved here from somewhere else. Most of us travel a lot more than we used to, and everyone has access to the internet these days, so you see a lot of images. So obviously the influences are not just the Midwest, but that is part of what, that's what we're talking about, and there, you know, these artists will say that yes, there are Midwestern influences. This is an artist whose work is completely different. Her name is Bonnie Peterson, and she lives in Houghton, Michigan, which is in the Upper Peninsula. And Bonnie describes herself as a rabble rouser. She said she only makes a quilt if it's meaningful to her. And this is a quilt that she made in conjunction. Apparently there was a program at the University of Wisconsin, it sounds fantastic, where they paired artists and scientists, and with the goal of helping educate the public by hoping that the artists could make creations that would help educate the public. Bonnie was paired with limnologists, water and lake scientists, who were working especially on trying to educate lake property owners about some of the issues related to water quality. And you know, the rusty the crayfish is an invasive species, and some other things related to water issues. Bonnie has an MBA, and she loves statistics, and she loves graphs, so that's part of what she really enjoyed, putting those in there. And I have a detail because I want you to see close up. She also writes a lot of text, so those are definitions that she free motion quilted with her sewing machine. She doesn't expect people to read everything, but she said if somebody gets one thing out of the quilt, that would make her very happy. And the thing I really love about this work too is it kind of harkens back to what some people call the very first art quilts, which are crazy quilts. And those are those quilts that you see in antique stores now, where they have a lot of dark, rich fabrics, and the pieces are embellished with embroidery stitches. And some people have said those are maybe the first art quilts. And Bonnie very much gives credit to the crazy quilt as being something that inspires her. And the next artist, again, something completely different, Diane Nunez. She's from Southfield, Michigan, and she spent most of her life around Detroit. And this quilt, this piece always gets the inevitable question, is it a quilt? And I don't know, Astrid, if you're going to talk in yours a little bit about the definition of a quilt, but layers that are held together with sewing or knotting, that's pretty much the definition of a quilt, and each one of these pieces is. She works in for a company that makes something like agricultural sprayers or something, and she said there's a lot of metal and mesh around, so she's very familiar with those materials. And she also was a jeweler, so she enjoys working with metals. And she said this piece was inspired by the rolling hills and the way the light and shadow plays off of them in Michigan, the hills that she sees. So this is Jackie Gehring, and Jackie is from Kansas City. When she made this quilt, she was from Chicago, and she had just moved to Chicago and didn't know anyone, and she has a dog, Bruno, and she was spending a lot of time walking Bruno, and every day she was walking under bridges, and she said she came home one day and she pieced this quilt. And I should say, for anyone who's not familiar with the difference between piecing and quilting, piecing is taking pieces of fabric and sewing them together. The quilting is the sewing that holds the layers together. So Jackie pieced the top and then she put it online. Jackie's a very well-known quilter, and she has a blog, Tallgrass Prairie Studios, and she put it on her blog and someone wrote her right away and said, I want to quilt that. And the woman who wanted to quilt it had worked with civil engineers. So they collaborated and decided to leave some of these areas open so that you could read words, and those are unquilted areas. And up at the top left corner, this is the binding of the quilt, and Jackie said she purposefully left that corner open because she said, you never know what's going to happen. And indeed, by the time the book was going to press, she had moved back from Chicago to Kansas City. So, and Jackie actually is going to be speaking at the Old Capitol Quilt Guild next month, the first Monday of the month. And she is the president of the Modern Quilt Guild, which is a national movement. But that's a whole other story. We won't go there today. But she's a great speaker. And the next quilt is done by Donna Katz, and Donna's from Chicago. And this is called Hoagy Carmichael Stardust, and it's based on the music of some of Hoagy Carmichael's songs, and particularly has images of Indiana in it. And this is a whole cloth quilt. And so rather than pieces, it's one piece of cloth. And Donna uses a thinned acrylic to paint the images on it. She then uses very minimal and random stitching to provide texture to her quilts. So the images in this quilt include the state bird of Indiana. The leaves on the far right are the tulip tree, which is the state tree of Indiana. And the constellations are based on the song Stardust. And the little postcards are the Wabash River, scenes from the Wabash River. She's really fond of topography, and these are maps that are along the edges, topographical maps of the river. And she also worked for a while as a docent at the Field Museum, and her other piece in the book has a lot of fossils and geological references. They're based on things that she learned in the Field Museum. And she has assured me that Chicago has a lot of areas where you can get out in nature and not even know you're in the city, which I haven't found them yet. But she said along the river she does a lot of birding or along the lake, excuse me. The next artist is from St. Louis, and her name is Luann Reimel. And some of the artists in the book very purposefully want their work to be associated with women's work and with it that has to do with quilting in the past. Others don't, but Luann very much does. And this piece, she loves photography. She's very interested in the passing of time, and these pictures are taken at the Bellefontaine Cemetery in St. Louis. And Eric's nodding his head. He knows that cemetery. Bell Fountain. Okay, thank you.
I say everything wrong. All the French words
are mispronounced. Okay. So, all right, the Bell Fountain Cemetery. And it's called Knowledge. And she takes the photographs. I told her also, by the way, if she came here, we have a great cemetery that I could take her to. So she shoots the photos, and then she has a 17-inch printer, and she prints these on cotton flour sack dish towels. And part of the reason she does that, I loved when she told me this story, was that she had been in Japan, and she had learned about Boro textiles, which are those like shirts and pants that have been repaired. They're often indigo blue, and they're from the, I think, the 18th and 19th centuries, and they're now being treated like works of art, but they were just things that you wore out, you know, to dig a ditch or that kind of thing. I just actually saw one yesterday at an antique sale, and it was very beautiful. But she's very inspired by that, so that's part of this piecing that she's done. But she also just really likes the idea of using domestic textiles. And she told me that that she uses dish towels in part because when she was growing up, she and her sisters always had to do the dishes, and she hated doing the dishes. But she always, when she looks back on it, she realized they were always singing or talking or laughing, and it turned out to be a very fun time. And she said that when she first got married, her husband's family was a really quiet family. And it wasn't until she and her mother-in-law would go in and do the dishes, and her mother-in-law would hand her a flour sack towel to dry, that she would start talking and start telling her stories about her son, Luann's husband. So she just really has that fondness for these domestic textiles for that reason, and sees them as sort of a conduit for conversation and related to memory. So I thought that was a lovely story. She then, after she prints them, she does this really, and I have this detail so you can see the stitching, really detailed stitching, and she'll even change the direction of the stitching. So around some of the fingers, you can see it changes direction, and on some of the patches, and she'll change the color of thread very subtly so that the light plays off of them in different ways. This is probably one of the more traditional quilts in the book. This is by Shelley Burge from Lincoln, Nebraska, and it's called Prairie Serenade. And it's really artfully done, I think. I think the selection of that color value for that sky and that windmill is just really nicely done. I love the way she used all the homespuns and the plaids for the bird and the piece of wood that it's on. Shelley, she was working on a quilt that would tie in with Willa Cather's Nebraska. And in Willa Cather's books, there's a lot of talk about meadowlarks and being the harbinger of spring. And Shelley lives on a farm outside Lincoln, so she's really tuned into that. If you're a quilter, you'd be interested to know that she made this quilt and then she didn't like it. And she ripped the binding off and cut some off the top and some off the bottom and the whole 6 or 8 inches off the side on the left. And then she very purposefully cut those homespuns on the left haphazardly and pieced them quickly because she thought that that would make it look more like a utility quilt that somebody would use, just not an artful quilt, but a quilt that just put those scraps together to keep your family warm if you lived in a sod house. And I think that really has gone a long way toward making this quilt a really successful quilt. The next one is by Beth Markle. And Beth is from Rochester Hills, Michigan. And she learned to quilt when she was young. She shared a bedroom with her grandmother, who was born in 1894, who was a quilter. And she would thread the needles for her when she could no longer see to thread the needles. And Beth was a photographer for many years and then a ceramist. And she said that she loves the combination, the quilting, because it combines sort of the tactileness of pottery with the visual of photography. And this is called In Vino Veritas, and it's based on being with a woman in her vineyard. And she said the small little pieces were when she was down with these sharp scissors, cutting very carefully. It was a little tedious. And then she would look up, and there would be these wide open areas across the vineyard. And this was her depiction of that experience. And she also says there are no ugly fabrics. So, and I love that because she obviously will use every fabric. She has a lot of solids, but some prints too. But she just loves to cut and piece and cut and piece and cut and piece until she feels like it's just right. And the last one I'm going to show you is by Shinhee Chin, who had his image is also on the cover of the book. This one is called People of the Wind. And actually, Astrid pointed out that in a magazine she brought, there's an article about Shinhee up here at the end. You could come up and take a look. She is from McPherson, Kansas. She's an art professor at Tabor College. And she originally emigrated from Korea. And she's lived on the East Coast and the West Coast and in Michigan. And she told me that her art was so important to her because she came and lost her language, basically. And her art was really the only way she had to communicate. And she's an amazing artist. Her work is so detailed. Each of these faces is hand-stitched, and she said, I just feel like I can get so much more depth than I ever could with a pencil, with a needle and thread. And she also is very, another thing that's really important for her is using recycled materials, and this is actually an old silk coverlet that they had in their family, and she told me each of these squares, you know, was stuffed, and she cut a hole in the back and got her vacuum cleaner and sucked out the remaining feathers and then and used it. And she said she really loves to do this, number one, because you never worry about messing up a used textile. You know, it's not like you have an expensive piece of fabric. And number two, she loves that connection with the woman before her who made this. She feels that's an important part of the legacy, and she really likes to continue it. So next up is Astrid Bennet, who wrote the foreword very kindly and is a talented quilt artist in her own right. So.
Okay, now we get to test I Am Live. Well, that was a wonderful presentation, and now you know why you don't want to rely on artist statements to convey the entire text in a book, because the interviews that Linzee did with all these artists brought up so much more, so much richer a portrait of all these artists, and so much more interesting, makes for a much more interesting book, too. So. I wanted to talk a little bit about art quilting. Art quilts, are they really a new invention? Linzee touched upon this a little bit. When our early forebears in this country used a lot of scraps to make patchwork quilts, sometimes small bits in the evenings after a long day, sometimes this and their flower gardens were the part of beauty in their lives in rural living. But a lot of times quilts had names, the patterns had names, there were formal aspects, and you would hardly think that people took their own path with these, but I would argue that a lot of people saw this as a personal expression. And during that time, we also had a lot of crazy quilts and commemorative quilts that would also commemorate events and so forth. So really, we have the roots of art quilting go a long time ago. And the word quilt actually goes back to medieval times, and it's related to the word mattress. So what has happened is there's been really an outpouring of creativity about art quilting that happened in the 1970s. Jonathan Holstein published a famous book called The American Quilt. And it was based on a show that was held in New York in one of the major museums. And suddenly, people looked at American quilts and said, wow, this is in the days of abstract expressionism and so forth. You can just picture. This gave it suddenly a much more of a provenance. This is about the time that a lot of art quilters first discovered quilting. And it's about shortly thereafter that Studio Art Quilts Associates was established. And that was a group that really wanted to go beyond patchwork quilting and come into a more individualized creative expression. What happened with me personally at that time, I was a printmaking student, and I saw that book and I said, wow, this is really different from traditional Western composition that you see in a painting. Look at this. This is all about modular work. This opens up a whole new range of ideas. This and kente cloth, which, by the way of small world, I will say my kente cloth came from Dennis Falk, and Dennis was in the Peace Corps with Nora and Chris Roy, who are here at the university and so forth. So anyway, I started looking at that and started my own odyssey in textiles because of the art quilts and because of the kente cloths and the patterns that I associated with those. If you ever study weaving and quilting and so on, it's fascinating to learn the names of a lot of patterns. There's a lot of poetry in them. So we have many Midwest contributions. We have probably the oldest and most significant quilt show in the country. It's Quilt National. And I'm very pleased and humbled to say I am included in the next one coming up. At the Quilt Study Center, as Linzee mentioned, we have key players like Nancy Crow, who has quilted amazing pieces over the years and had her quilt sell for $30,000. We have scores of large local guilds and quilt shops and a heritage of making things. As the gallery owner, I can tell you it's common that I have customers come in and say, oh, I could make that myself. We know it's not so easy, but we appreciate the fact that people are creative. I wanted to talk a little bit about our quilters per se, because against the backdrop of all these quilt guilds, we have a number of quilters who decide that traditional patterns and piecework isn't quite enough for them, and they want to stray out. They have seen that some people are dying works and printing and so on, and they want to make their own. In 2007, Julia Pfaff, who teaches out east, did an article for one of the quilting magazines where she said 1 in 12 Americans quilts, which was a phenomenal statistic, and talk about an economic powerhouse, really. Art quilters in that group are probably maybe 10 to 15%, but they aren't content to adopt other people's ideas. They use the quilt top for their own palette. Some of them continue to piece, some of them do whole cloth. Still more create their own fabrics and use quilting as a sturdy way to present their compositions. And I basically fall into that category. I've been doing textile work after I left printmaking. I wanted to print on cloth and started weaving my surfaces and then ended up in quilting myself. Now I'm doing a variety of things as well as quilting. I brought several things today because this isn't really a presentation about me. I think it's more important that we hear what Erick has to say as one of the artists included. But I wanted to point out that this is one of my pieces. You can see that it's had a lot of, this started out as white fabric. It's got hand painting and a lot of mono printing, which I print on flexible vinyl and then flop down. These are dyes thickened with sodium alginate that is used to thicken ice cream. And you build up lots of transparent layers. My backs are also my own fabrics, so I never buy any patterned fabrics. They're all my own fabrics. And that, to me, is perhaps the most fun. The making of fabrics, which I do kind of in the manner of Erick Carl, make lots of fabrics, and then I have some piecing sessions where I start piecing like mad. I brought here a couple other pieces. This piece here has a lot of artist hands put into a screen, silk screen, which I've screen printed on here. And I use drop cloths and such on the backs of my pieces. You're welcome to touch them and handle them. That's part of the reason why a lot of us do this. It's because we love the tactile. Here is a silk screen, just a small one. I have about 40 at home. And I have a basket here of different fabrics. These are all made by me just to play with and look at. So you're welcome to just pick them up, look at them, and so forth. I say this partly because this is a town of many opportunities. This Sunday there's a concert at the Angler with the Iowa City Community String Orchestra, which I'm in the rehearsals right now. So I don't know if you have questions, but you're also welcome to email me through my website if you have any questions you don't see. There's some pictures of how I actually produce the work there. So thank you all for coming.
All right, well, while the screen is up, I'll take this opportunity to talk a little bit about the work you're seeing here. First of all, I guess I'm kind of a natural teacher, so I'm going to teach a little bit. Who sees the relationship between these two quilts? Like, what's the obvious thing that's happening here that's, you would say, is similar or the same in each of them? What do you see? I saw your hand go up.
Up there and down there.
Up there and down there. And what do you see that's similar about them?
The
shape?
Geometric oblong shape.
Right, right. And even some of the colors, would you say? the kind of the green hues. That's right. So I point that out to you, and thank you, to say that one quilt in my life begets another quilt. And that's part of my frugality. It's just like I have leftovers, and I use them, you know? So, and that really also becomes a metaphor for my own life and where my quilting kind of comes from, which is my own life story. I was not born Erick Wolfmeyer. I was born Thomas Kaiser. And at the age of 7 months, I was adopted by the family that raised me. I met my birth mother and subsequently my birth father when I was 21 years old. I'm currently 47. I guess I was still a student at Washington University in St. Louis. And my father was conveniently in St. Louis at the time. My mother, however, lived in Montreal with my half-brother, Scott. They currently live in Southern California. So a lot of my work is really about piecing together sort of the losses that I experienced as an adoptee and the lifelong journey that that's been for me, sort of figuring that all out. I have a wonderful therapist here in town. Thank you, Holly Sanger. 5 years running. She's awesome. It really is such an obvious, almost trite metaphor, but to say that for me, quilts have been like piecing my life back together. And it really has been a wonderful journey. I've quilted since 1998. Quilts sort of found me. I was in Sisters, Oregon on vacation. Sisters is known for having a beautiful outdoor quilt show every summer. They have a luxury in the mountains of having predictably dry weather. So they can put all these quilts outside. And it's just great. Well, I got there about a week after that stumbled into a quilt store and bought a pattern, my first pattern, and made a baby quilt for some friends. And I just got this response from people that I could just see that people really, they saw something that I didn't really even see. And so I just kept making quilts through a failed attempt at graduate school and all kind of long stories. But it's what kept me going, because that's what people were responding to in my life. They saw these quilts and they were like, what? And then I discovered I could sell them, which was really exciting. I lost track. I've made 80 some quilts in 15 years, and I've sold most all of them. I have 5 right now, and that's unusual for me to have that many on hand. So I can talk way too much, so I will shut up, but I will tell you, I'll just introduce the video. This is the second production that I've done. I do a lot of speaking with quilt guilds, which has been really a fun opportunity for me. They're always looking for speakers. So this is my second production that I did. What can I tell you about it? It's people would often ask me, well, why do you quilt? You know, why? And it's hard to summarize, but the video is 6 short films, 6 3-minute films. Each one is about a different quilt of mine. And I think of them as diary entries. That if you were to look into my journal, which I don't have a journal, by the way, it would be like sort of an inside view of what I was thinking and what I was really feeling. And I've seen many a little tear come in the video, and I'm always thinking that, okay, I was successful because I moved somebody. And that's what I'm meaning to do, is to kind of, not only for you to understand what these quilts mean to me, but that you can also bring your experience, your joys, your sorrows, your losses, to the work and to the video, et cetera. So we'll go ahead and show that. It's about 23 minutes long. And then if there are any questions afterwards, I'd be happy to take them. That is true. Yep. Before we started, I should say that the first quilt featured in the video is the quilt that traveled in China for a year. It went to 6 major museums there, and then timing worked out such that it could be in the book as well. So you'll see that featured. And then this quilt in the video, it's the last video you'll see, and it wasn't finished at the time. So I was happy to be able to bring it. And I'm thrilled to say you'll get to meet Taffy in the video as well. She plays a starring role. And a little comic relief at the end. So when you see Taffy, you'll know it's over if you're getting antsy.
Well, I'm on my way to I was born moving. My father was a race car driver. My mother was a chorus line dancer. She danced with me until she was 7 months pregnant. Since the day I passed from her arms to those of my next family, I've been trying to find my way in this world. I have two names, two mothers, and two fathers. I am Thomas Kaiser and Erick Wolfmeyer. No matter how many times I tell my story, it will never be complete. Artists need obstacles. This has been mine.
That's not part of the film.
It's, well.
I thought it was part of the art. Sorry.
Okay, let's do, put it through. And can we advance it at all? We can advance it. Okay. Sorry. That has not happened before, so.
And we need to get out of Linzee.
Well, you have to. This is just the intro. Yeah, it's all right. And we'll just slide through this. Just click. Oh, a little further. And let's just go with there. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if we could just go full screen.
Where's the screen?
Oh, right here, probably.
No, that closes it.
That square.
Oh.
Well, that's not quite
close enough.
How about view?
The only thing that lasts is the essence of things. All of life is connected by a thin thread, an innate presence. Nothing is as it seems, and yet everything is exactly as it is. The stars are there in the sky all the time, even when shrouded by daylight. Absence of knowledge, lack of experience, or faded memory cannot change what is inherently true. These stars are, after all, where we come from. These expanding, soaring, falling stars. A quilt is a map of the world, the one that came before, the one that lives inside, and the one that is yet to come. Portmanteau is a quilt once called Revolution. It is two truths coexisting and proof positive that every choice matters. Who knows what dreams are unlocked when pieces are mended together? A vision from deep within brought to life, a sum greater than its parts. How could I have known where Portmanteau would take me? Like a flying carpet, it took me to China. As if waking from a dream, we swim from one life to the next. Along a double helix liturgy of seasons, we meet ourselves again and again, transfigured by the many ways of knowing. Wherever we were before, passage into this world required that we become small. We grew and continued to grow until our cells remembered that it was time to stop. And then what? Did we continue to grow even after our bodies began to wither? Transformed from created to creator, made to maker? In beds, many of our lives will also end there. These bed covers, then, are vestments for a holy place. And they are how I know that I am here. Thank you.
Kind Heavenly Father, we want to thank Thee, Lord, for being with us up to the present moment of time. We thank Thee for Thy sweet Spirit. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for Thy children and our brothers and sisters and friends and loved ones. And we thank Thee for this community. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for the many sweet blessings of life. And oh, God, we'd ask You to continue to bless us in a way to be pleasing with Thee. Heavenly Father, bless all whom it's our duty to pray for from the rivers to the end of the earth. Heavenly Father, we'd ask You to go with us, each one of us, as to our respective places of abode. Heavenly Father, would Thou be the driver and lead and guide us, and hover over us, oh God, and give us more faith for one another, more faith, Lord, and more love for one another for Thee. That we might ever walk in that straight and narrow path that leads to mercy and glory. Heavenly Father, we might look beyond the grave, for the singing will just begin. There won't be no more heartaches and sin and sorrow, but it'll all be happiness and peace and love. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for the promise of the home on the other side. Now, God, we'd ask You to choose all that sin before, and live and abide with us now and forevermore. So we ask it in the name of Jesus.
I had always thought of it as an oasis, a valley where the only trees are the bur oaks convened along dry creek beds, and the smell of sweet grass lasts only as long as it takes to get used to. She told me it was first called Minnewashta, Lakota for good water, one of the few places about which could be said, so near the Badlands of South Dakota. I was trying to find a place I'd been only once before. 15 years earlier, I'd been invited by a friend to see the early stages of her friend's lifelong dream of turning the old Wasta Hotel into a place for family gatherings. Over the years, the memory of that experience had taken on a mystical quality, as if it had all been some kind of mirage I half expected to find nothing. But in such a small town, it didn't take long. From behind a screen door, he waved me in out of the warm rain and that summer's nearly apocalyptic infestation of grasshoppers. He smiled and listened as I gave an account of why I was there and gently assured me I was in the right place. He told me she was diagnosed with cancer, recently home from the hospital in Rapid City, and doing fine. He invited me in, asked me to wait in the lobby while he found her, then guided me back to the long galley kitchen where one could easily imagine garden fresh meals served to weary homesteaders or starry-eyed miners en route to Deadwood. Lloyd called back to her, "Margie, I have someone here for you to meet." The measure of her graceful composure belied that of her height as she stepped through the door, looked up, and without pause, called me by name. "Erick!" Though we may be but wayfaring strangers, home is the place where all are remembered and welcomed with open arms. Do you know how we stop that? So then, there.
She's right on time, right on cue. Well, while we're getting that shut off, the one story I like to tell is my favorite thing to tell after the video, since you've seen it now. One of my favorite pieces ended up being the one about my family reunion. Those were taken, actually some of those were before I was even in this, on the scene. But the little boy you saw a lot was actually my brother, who's 4 years older than me. But you remember the picture at the end where they're standing like this in the back, and you think, how or why would you ever have a picture of people from the backside like that? Well, you could tell that they were gathering for a family photo. This was the old man with the string tie was my great-grandfather, and the youngest woman in the picture is my Aunt Pearl. She's now in her 90s. She's in Keokuk, Iowa. And the story my mother told me is, when I asked her, how did I ever get this picture from the back? Well, my grandmother took it because the woman that it's dedicated to was really upset about the fact that Pearl wore culottes or shorts, because that was considered very racy. And so they wanted to put her in the back of the picture to hide her legs. And of course, my grandmother, being kind of a trickster that she was, wanted to get a picture to record that. And so that's how I ended up with a picture of them from the backside. But it did make a really, I think, a nice tribute for me to kind of think about, you know, all those people are now, with my exception of my Aunt Pearl, are now gone. So I just thought about it. Just looks like they're, you know, all kind of together wherever we go. It was fun to see this piece being made, huh? Like, I was like, oh, this is kind of neat that I get to show you the whole thing, and you got to kind of see the kind of how the sausage is made, so to speak. And I forgot to mention earlier that this piece is really was inspired by the November or February kind of in Iowa when you've still got some green popping up, color, you know, this mix of fall colors and still the green grass. And so this is very much rooted in my Iowa City, Iowa experience. Part of the reason I made the video the way I did it shows the tedium and the time that goes into making quilts. And this one particularly, I really wrestled with it. I got the bottom done, finally, with some math help from my friend Greg. I couldn't decide what to do with the top, and I had probably 4 failed attempts. And this top is actually inspired by the tile work under the eaves at the Dana Thomas House in Springfield, Illinois, the Frank Lloyd Wright. So once again, a Midwestern Illinois connection, and I grew up in Illinois. And so then when I happed upon this little pattern that I used to interpret that, those tile, like I said, then that ended up getting translated on a larger scale to this piece, which itself is also inspired by tile, by Heath, the Heath Tile Company, based in Sausalito, California. And that was actually started by a woman from Iowa many years ago. And these were 2 tile patterns that I saw there when I visited the plant a long time ago, put that all away, never thought about it again. And then when I stumbled on their website one day, I saw these gorgeous patterns that I wanted to replicate. Funny thing is, I went back to my pictures of my visit to the tile factory, and I noticed I had lots of pictures of these very patterns. So they must have spoken to me even upon my visit. But this is really about not about being in Iowa and not being by the ocean and not being by big bodies of water. This is really about, I look at maps all day for my job. This piece is called Map of the World, which you heard me use that phrase in the video of, in reference to another quilt. But I look at maps all day for my job. I schedule all the field trips and charters for the Iowa City School District, over 2,000 trips a year. So I'm constantly making maps and looking at Google Maps and giving directions and pulling my hair out. But this is really inspired by that experience, but also by my love for water and how water has been a constant theme in my life. I was born on the Mississippi River, and I've lived on rivers and bodies of water almost all my life. The Iowa River is probably one of the smallest bodies or rivers I've lived on before. So, and like I said earlier, there's always kind of a thread of connection between one quilt to the next. And these are obviously both very heavily pieced, but I'll quit talking. Do you have any questions about the video, the work, anything?
Oh, come on, somebody has to have a question.
Erick, can you tell us about how many pieces are in that quilt?
I can tell you exactly if I look on the back. So all my quilts have a tag that this quilt, anyone want to guess? No? All right. 2,828.
Oh, that was my guess.
I have a prize. There's a prize later. Okay, which one do you think has more pieces?
Oh,
this one? You're correct. 4,228.
Erick, that last piece, what was the last piece that, the one about that quilt, what was it called?
One Life. This is called One Life.
That was just remarkable. I'm not a quilter, and just to see what you did was amazing.
I am not a speed quilter. I mean, a lot of you'll see classes like in magazines, make this quilt in a weekend, you know, and it's like, that's not how I work. I mean, you saw that each one of these are individually pieced. These are three strips that are sewn together. These are, you know, little pieces that make this square, and you saw me even placing them. Once I get them made, how I individually place them. So there is a lot of intention in the
so
work.
So can you even estimate how much time you spent on that quilt?
I think this was 8 months.
8 months?
Yeah. But you know, I work full time, and I work very part time on these. So, and they take about 3 to 4 months to be quilted. I have all my work hand quilted by Amish women that I unfortunately never get to meet or know their names by their choice. That's their cultural tradition. I do have a Mennonite broker in Shipshawana, Indiana, that I send all my work to, and then she will then farm it out to various quilters as they are available to finish the work. So these are all hand quilted. Yes.
Wait, Erick.
Oh, Mike. Oh. It's like Phil Donahue. Here, I got long legs. Okay.
Erick, I was wondering, in working with quilters that you don't meet, do you direct or instruct the quilting at all, or is that part of your vision, or do you kind of leave it to their sense of it?
Well, one day I was out walking Taffy, and that's right, sorry, I'm used to having one. And I got a call from my quilter, and I sat down on someone's stoop, when the house was for sale, was empty, and we had a discussion about, well, what are we going to do with this quilt? And so it's really a collaboration. I have a general idea in mind, but being that she and her Amish quilters, that's what they do, and they spend months doing it, I really let them, I want them to enjoy it and really to have a part of them in it. So all these works end up really being collaborative artworks. I couldn't do it without them. I really couldn't. And that's also been a really important part of my story, the aspect of who's quilting them. And it really was what brought me to Iowa originally, because I used to have them quilted up in Dyersville by a woman there who would farm them out to various Catholic church groups in and around Dyersville. So it's definitely a collaboration. I would say I feel like it's more them than me, but really, we almost always end up in the same place. So, you look familiar.
I took a class from you at Home Ec.
Oh, that's right. Yep. I knew
my granddaughter loves her quilt.
Oh, thank you.
I Skype with her, and it's on the background, and it's like makes me happy every time. Anyway, my question is, how did you and Linzee hook up for the book? I mean, did you hear the call for the artists, or did Linzee say, Erick, you've got to try and be in this book? I mean, did the other judges pick him? How did this happen that both of you live in Iowa City and you're in the book?
Well, I mean,
dogs. Let me just say dogs.
If they would apply, in addition to putting out a call, you know, when I was in Houston at International Quilt Festival, I saw some quilters who I thought were outstanding, and I asked them to submit work. I asked Erick to submit work, but I didn't have the final say. It was a juried process, and there were three of us, and so Erick's work was juried into the book. Erick is the only man who's in the book, and the only Iowan in the book. And I wanted to say, as I was watching this, that for me, this just reminded me how much fun I had writing this book, because I got to learn all these amazing things about all these really fascinating artists as I wrote it. And I got excited all over again listening to Erick's story, so.
Thank you, Linzee.
Yes.
Hi, do you have a question?
Well, and actually it's perhaps for both of you,
yeah.
And especially for Linzee. I very much enjoyed your film, the presentation, it's lovely. And I was so excited. I was thinking about, as you introduced it, the importance of place and your experiences and so forth. Linzee, do you plan to do a book on the West, quilts of the West? California, I was thinking about the influence you talked about. Have you considered that at all? Or
I have not.
Strictly in the Midwest. Because I could just envision, you were just talking about water also, and I thought, wouldn't that be lovely?
Yeah, I mean, it could be. I could go all over, you know, parts of the United States.
Yeah.
I hadn't
thought
about it. So
regionally.
I'll have to think about
that.
Yeah.
The series.
That's serious. Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Other questions?
Okay, this is sort of off the wall, but I don't think I'll ever hear that song by Rufus Wainwright quite the same again. So what do you listen to while you're quilting?
You know, that's a great observation. That's part of the reason I use the music I did, because I almost always have music on. The news is too depressing anymore. I used to listen to NPR all the time. And some of my quilts actually ended up being completely influenced. For example, I have a quilt called Rapture, which was the financial crash and the Haitian earthquake were going on all at the same time. And so, you know, no, it's actually orange and very bright, like the world's on fire. So, but I really just put on, a lot of times I listen to KCRW, which is a station out of Santa Monica. They have a fabulous mix, kind of keeps me in touch with my West Coast friends and culture, and or just, you know, hit my shuffle on my computer. But I listen to all kinds, and all those things, of course, are in my collection, but I specifically chose that music to really be evocative and to be kind of draw out an emotional response. So, yeah, I'm glad you liked it. Thank you.
This is just for art quilters in general, but what's the most or more a most satisfying end to your work? Seeing it displayed on a wall or seeing a piece on a bed as a function, as a functional
piece?
That
is a great question, and I'm going to answer it in the most honest way I can. It's being here and seeing people smile. Yeah, it really is. She's gone. The woman that was sitting right next to you, Suzanne, I think she was smiling the whole time. And I, honestly, I couldn't put a price on that.
I think she was a little bored.
But really, I mean that. I mean that.
Erick and I go way back.
Yeah.
You can get away with it.
She's a plant.
I quilted my basement.
I did.
I never saw you quilt that fast.
True story.
Linzee, what about your quilts?
I make very functional quilts. Not very often do I think up the pattern myself.
I have one of your quilts on my bed.
You do have one of your quilts. Nice. That's right. I forgot that. So yeah,
you
not.
You can be in the next book,
babe. Yeah, quilts of Maeve's bed. So. Boy, that's gonna
That'd
be
easy. I just have to come right down the street and it
with
would
the
be
dog and the cat on the quilts of my bed. Do we have any more questions? Well, this was just, oh, we do have more questions.
I have one quick personal question. I want to know if you make your bed every day.
No one's ever asked me that, but I'm so glad you did. I don't, and I don't have any of my own quilts on my bed.
Yeah.
They're
gasps from the audience.
I have old, ratty quilts that are falling apart that I've gotten over the years, and I slowly work my way. They work their way in the garbage because taffy will get up on the bed and all that sort of stuff. So, no, I don't. But it feels so good when I do. I should do it more often, really. Yeah.
Everybody go home and get those quilts out, because I know you've all got them. And put them on your bed and then take them off. But at least put them on your bed. So thank you all for coming. This was a wonderful program.